सर।
ओके सो यस्टरडे वी वर जस्ट फोकसिंग ऑन द लूप थिंग। सो टुडे विल बी आवर फाइनल पाइथन क्लास वेयर वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट वन मोर क्वेश्चन ऑफ लूप एंड देन वी विल बी फोकसिंग ऑन लाइक द एप्लीकेशन पोर्शंस ऑफ पाइथन। नाउ द मेजर एप्लीकेशन पोर्शन ऑफ पाइथन, लाइक इफ यू वांट टू गेट इनटू अ वास्ट फील्ड ऑफ द एप्लीकेशन, इज लाइक इन वेब डेवलपमेंट और अ पर्टिकुलर लेट्स से ऐप डेवलपमेंट और सॉफ्टवेयर डेवलपमेंट, एंड दैट इज वे टू कॉम्प्लेक्स एज ऑफ नाउ, राइट? वी डोंट हैव टू फोकस ऑन दोस थिंग्स स्पेसिफिकली, बट वंस यू अंडरस्टैंड लाइक द बेसिक्स ऑफ ऑल लाइक हाउ पाइथन वर्क्स एंड व्हाट आर द डिफरेंट लूपिंग थिंग एंड ऑल दोस थिंग्स, देन इट बिकम्स क्वाइट इजी फॉर यू टू लाइक स्टार्ट विथ योर ओन डेवलपमेंट ऑफ लाइक अ वेबसाइट और अ पर्टिकुलर ऐप और व्हाटएवर सॉफ्टवेयर यू वांट टू डू, राइट? So today we will be just seeing like basic examples of how like basic very simple applications of Python and how you can like transfer those things onto a particular let's say machinery or a hardware, right? So we won't be looking at specifically how to transfer that on a hardware, and but we will be seeing like what is the basic logic or the basic coding behind after once you've written your code. So after you transfer the code to your hardware, what is the first step of writing those codes and how those codes are actually written out? Okay, so first we'll just look at a very basic example of something called as a Fibonacci sequence. So can anyone tell me what Fibonacci sequence is and what like exactly is the significance of a Fibonacci number?
वो नेक्स्ट नंबर उसमें ऐड होता ही चला जाता है, वजह से 1 + 2 2, फिर वो 1 3 में ऐड हो जाएगा तो 2 की जगह 3, फिर वो अगले नंबर्स में ऐड होते ही चला जाता है वो सीक्वेंस। मतलब
तो बेसिकली जो नेक्स्ट नंबर हमको मिलेगा दैट विल बी, फॉर एग्जांपल जैसे तुमने बोला कि 2 में हमने 1 ऐड किया 3 मिल गया,
हाँ,
फिर नेक्स्ट नंबर क्या होगा? 3 + 1 मतलब 4 होगा।
हाँ, 3 + 1 मतलब, या फिर शायद पिछ, हाँ, नेक्स्ट कुछ ऐसा ही रहता है कि मतलब सी में पढ़ा था वैसे ही है कुछ। एग्जैक्टली नहीं।
सो बेसिकली व्हाट अ फिबोनाची, सो बेसिकली व्हाट फिबोनाची सीक्वेंस इज कि जो भी तुम्हारा नेक्स्ट नंबर होगा दैट विल बी द एडिशन ऑफ लाइक प्रीवियस 2 नंबर्स, दैट इज व्हाट अ फिबोनाची सीक्वेंस इज। फॉर एग्जांपल लाइक लेट्स से कि तुमने 0 से स्टार्ट किया तो पहले 2 नंबर तुम्हारे पास 0 एंड 1 होंगे, तो नेक्स्ट नंबर क्या होगा? 0 एंड 1 का एडिशन, दैट इज 1। फिर जो नेक्स्ट नंबर होगा वो प्रीवियस 2 नंबर का एडिशन, तो अभी जो तुम्हारा प्रीवियस 2 नंबर है वो हो गया है। फॉर एग्जांपल लेट्स से हमारे पास 2 नंबर है 0 एंड 1, तो जो नेक्स्ट नंबर है दैट विल बी एडिशन ऑफ दिस 2 नंबर्स, सो 0 + 1 इज अगेन 1। अब जो नेक्स्ट नंबर होगा दैट विल बी द एडिशन ऑफ दिस 2 नंबर, प्रीवियस 2 नंबर, सो 1 + 1 विल नाउ बिकम 2, देन 2 + 1 विल बी 3, देन 3 + 2 विल बी 5, 5 + 3 विल बी 8, 8 + 5 विल बी 13 एंड सो ऑन। तो बेसिकली जो भी नेक्स्ट नंबर आएगा वो अपने प्रीवियस 2 नंबर का एडिशन होगा। That is what a Fibonacci sequence is, right? So, can anyone tell me what is the significance of this particular sequence? Like, why is it so popular? ये Fibonacci sequence बहुत जगह देखा होगा, तुमने movies में भी देखा होगा, ऐसे use है। For example, Da Vinci Code में भी बहुत बार इसका use हुआ है movies में। So, like, what basically is the significance of this particular sequence?
Sir, pattern, I guess, like to recognize some kind of patterns or something. If we
like Morse code,
right? So, but the thing is, ki jo Fibonacci sequence is a particular, is a very universal like sequence. For example, jo bhi flowers hum log dekhte hain, to unke jo petals hote hain, they are always in a number of a Fibonacci sequence. वो हमेशा एक फिबोनाची सीक्वेंस में ही किसी भी फ्लावर के पैटर्न तुमको, जो पेटल्स होते हैं वो तुमको मिलेंगे, लाइक 1 या फिर 1 तो बेसिकली कभी पेटल मिलता नहीं है, बट उसी सीक्वेंस मिलेगा लाइक 2, 5, 8, 13, 21 इस तरीके से, और कोई नंबर में मिलता ही नहीं है वो। एक तो ये चीज होता है। सेकेंड चीज इज कि वेन यू गो मोर डीप इन टू दिस पर्टिकुलर फिबोनाची सीक्वेंस, देन आई गेस यू ऑल मस्ट हैव हर्ड अबाउट द नंबर नोन एज अ गोल्डन रेशियो, कि यूनिवर्सल वो सेम होता है लाइक द रेशियो ऑफ हाइट टू विड्थ, वो बेसिकली गोल्डन रेशियो नंबर रहता है, एंड दैट इज अ वेरी यूनिवर्सल थिंग, राइट? यू कैन सी दैट पैटर्न इन अ शेल और इवन इन अ साइक्लोन फॉर्मेशन, सो दैट इज वेरी यूनिवर्सल थिंग, सो दैट्स व्हाई इसको बहुत अटेंशन ऐसा मिला हुआ है कि इट इज समथिंग विच इज वेरी यूनिवर्सल अराउंड द ग्लोब, राइट? सो इसलिए वजह से ये जो सीक्वेंस होते हैं ये काफी लाइक, सो एंड मेजोरिटी ऑफ द क्रिप्टोग्राफर्स जो होते हैं ना, जो क्रिप्टोग्राफिक्स करते हैं, या जो पजल एंड कोड ब्रेकिंग करते हैं दे मेजरली यूज दीज काइंड ऑफ सीक्वेंसेस. ओके सो नाउ वी विल बी लुकिंग एट हाउ टू एक्चुअली प्रिंट आउट द फिबोनाची सीक्वेंस. ओके सो नाउ यू गाइस नो व्हाट इज द बेसिक लॉजिक. हाउ डू यू थिंक वी शुड अप्लाई दैट लॉजिक इन पाइथन हियर व्हाइल कोडिंग फॉर इट.
So maybe we take a plus b and is equal to c and then you add the c plus one and I'm not sure, but then you add the product to the next number.
Okay, but then c plus one won't be valid, right? Because then what will happen is ki at every, so the very next number will always be just the addition of previous number with one. Right, but that's where your logic fails, right? Because Fibonacci sequence is always the addition of previous two numbers, not with one. So there are two ways via which we can do it to like show it very like very basic form is by with using the while loop. So let's say we have a Fibonacci sequence, and Fibonacci sequence will always start with two numbers, right? Because then only you can create a third number, because you have to have two numbers first, because then only you will add both of the number and then you get the third number, right? So let's say we define two numbers x and y, okay, and we give the value of x as 0 and y as 1. So can I do it in this way? Can I define the values of x and y in this way? Is it right or wrong?
Sir, it's wrong.
Okay.
So it's right because the comma separates, but we won't know for sure that x is equal to 0 and y is equal to 1. So
no, so basically this is right, because what happens is, as I told you in the last lecture, comma is basically a delimiter, right, that separates two variables and even their values. So what is happening here is that Python understands that user has defined two variables. And these two values, which are separated by comma, so it understands that the first value is given to the first variable and second value is given to the second variable. And we studied this in the very first class also, the very starting of the Python class. Okay. So you can define n number of variables here. You can write A, B, C, whatever you want. And then you can just give those values here separated by a comma. So Python understands that, okay, this is the these are the variables and these are the corresponding values that these variables will store. So now we know that to start the Fibonacci sequence, we have two numbers, x and y, and the values will always start from 0 and 1. Okay. Now, let's say I want to print my Fibonacci number up until 50. Let's say I want to go till 50, not more than that. So what I can do is I'll run my while loop saying while y is less than 50. Now, why I am giving the condition as for y, not for x? Can anyone tell me?
Sir, is it because it's the second variable?
Right. And so when you're right, just say it confidently, na? So that I understand it. You're right, because y is the second variable, right? So for example, let me just comment this out first. So we see, let's say there's any particular pattern, let's say this one or something like this, whatever it is, right? Now, so what we understood in Fibonacci number is that the next number is always the addition of the previous two number, right? So here what happens, this is your x and this is your y when your Fibonacci sequence starts, right? But once it starts, the sequence starts, then this particular number becomes your y and this becomes your x. Then in the next step, this becomes your y and this becomes your x. So in the similar way, if you go till 50, so the final 50 will actually be the value of y, right? Because that is the limit up until we want to go. So 50 will be the value of y. So that's why the condition that we have to give is up until y is less than 50, the loop will keep on repeating itself. Okay. So that we have given y less than 50. Now what we do is we want to print the value of y. we want to print y? Because y will be the final product when we add the previous two numbers, and that's what we want, right? That means we want to print the value of y only, not the value of x. Because when we add x plus y, that is what the product that we get after addition of those two numbers, and that's only what we want. We don't want the previous values to show us. So what we'll do it here, we'll just print the value of y. Now what happens is you have to update the number as well, because what happens is, let's say the initial value of x was 0 and y was 1. Now when these two numbers are added, the next number in the sequence is 1. And then, for example here, let's say the next number will become 1, and then the next number will become 2, then 3. So what is happening is, as the sequence goes on further, this number gets discarded. For example, let's say I add 0 plus 1, and this will give me the answer as 1, right? So in the next step, I only have to add these two numbers. This number is discarded from the sequence now. So this becomes x and this becomes y. And when we add these two numbers, the product is 2. And then for the next sequence, this number is discarded. Now this becomes x and this becomes y. So what is happening is, with every iteration of the sequence, the resulting product becomes y, and the previous number becomes, which was initially y, now it becomes x. So that is what is happening there, right? So for that condition also, we have to provide it here. So what we can do is, we will just write x, y, and we will update the value, saying that whatever x was, now it becomes y, and whatever y is, the updated value of y will become x plus y. Is this clear with everyone here? Why we have done this?
Yes.
Anyone has any doubt here for this particular code?
Also.
Okay. So now what we'll do is, so here our final function is completed for the Fibonacci sequence, and then we'll just write print. And it will provide me the output here. So 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21, 34. And after that, it goes beyond 50. So that's where the loop ends at here, right? So this is when you had your, let's say, initialized number. So number you have initialized. You have initialized a particular variable, right? So we can do it in another way. So another way to do it is whereby we want our user to give an input saying, till how many terms you want your Fibonacci number to repeat, or till how many terms you want your Fibonacci sequence to get the output. So in that, what we'll do is, let's say I define a particular variable called as n terms, let's say, right? And then this will be my user input. So what I'll do is, I'll just give it an integer input. So int input, and I'll write n terms. So this is basically a user input. So user will say, okay, this much terms should be involved in the Fibonacci sequence, and then give me whatever the sequence is, right? Now I have to do two numbers. Let's give the same numbers x and y. And the initial value of x will be 0, initial value of y will be 1. And then I will store the value, update the value according to my count. So I'll create another variable count, and I'll store the value, initialize the value of count as 0. Now I will update the count, and accordingly I will keep on updating my terms also. So this is the initialization portion. Now I'll give my conditions, saying that if my n terms is less than or equal to 0, then it will print saying there is an error. Why? Because if my n terms, the value of n term, whatever terms that you have given here, if it is equal to 0, then Fibonacci sequence won't start only, right? Because for the start of Fibonacci sequence, you have to give the terms, minimum terms as 2. Then only it can give you the final output of the Fibonacci sequence. So even if I give a negative value or a 0 value, the output will be an error, right? So this is for my first condition. Second, what I'll write is, saying that, let's say I give an elif condition saying, if my n terms is equal to 1, let's say I give 1 as my input term, what it will print is, it will just give me the answer saying print Fibonacci sequence is whatever the result will be. And then it will give me the final term, that is, it will give me the value of x here, right? Now why x? Because I have given the terms as only 1. So even if I give the initial term as 1, Fibonacci sequence won't start, because for to start the Fibonacci sequence, you have to have two numbers, right? So if the user has given one, then it will only give the first value, that is zero. So it will only give me the value of x. So the output will be Fibonacci sequence is zero, the value of x. Because for one, you can't start the Fibonacci sequence. And then finally, the last loop will be where actual Fibonacci sequence or the user gives terms more than two, like two or more than two, and then the Fibonacci sequence will start here. So what I can write is, I will write else print Fibonacci sequence is, and then here I will start my while loop because I have to loop it up until whatever terms the user has given me. So what I'll write is, while my count is less than the n terms. So now, because I'm updating my Fibonacci sequence with the help of count, so the condition that I have is, while my count is less than n terms, that means whatever the input user has given, that will be the upper range up until which my while loop will keep on iterating itself. And the condition according to which it will iterate is count. So the condition is, up until my count is less than n terms, the loop will keep on iterating itself. As soon as the count goes beyond the n terms that is provided by the user, the loop will break out from here, and whatever output you have, that will be the final end result of your Fibonacci sequence. So I will write count, while count is less than n terms, what it will do is, it will first print my first term, that is x, because Fibonacci sequences start from 0, then 1, then 0 plus 1 is 1, then 1 plus 1 is 2, 8, something like this. So initially it will start from 0. So the very first thing I have to print here is print the value of x, that is value of x is 0. So it will first start off with 0, and then let's say I define next term as nth term. That is the sum of the previous two terms. That is what I've defined by nth value. And then it will be equal to x plus y, right? So this will be my next term. Now I have to update my term, saying that when this addition happens here, the previous value, that means my previous variable, which was x, it will now become y. And whatever my y was, it will become the nth term, because that will be the next addition that you will do once, and whatever the previous value of x was, that will be discarded. So for example, it is 0, 1 and then 1. So what happens is, initially x value is 0, y is 1, and then when you add both of them together, that will give you the nth value. Now what happens is, when the next iteration happens, the value of x, which was 0, that is now dropped, and the value of x now becomes y, that is 1, right? So if I have something like this, had 0, 1, 1, 2. So what happened was, initially x value was 0, y was 1, and then it added both of these together and gave you the nth value here. For the next iteration, this value is dropped out. So what happened was, initially my value, which was x, now the x takes this particular value. So, and this was initially y. So that's why this quote comes here. That is, x now becomes y, and whatever y was, now it becomes the nth value. That means initially this was my nth value, but now the value of nth is equal to y. So that's why I have to give these two terms as, and these are known as your updating the terms, that you are updating your initial two letters, and you have to keep on updating itself. And then what you will do is, you will increase the count by one. That is, your count will also increase by one. And now count basically here means that the next iteration will happen. Count here doesn't mean that it will add one to your previous number. Count basically means, now that your first iteration is over, go to the second iteration, go till third iteration, up, and this count will go up until n terms, like less than n terms, whatever the user has defined. For example, let's say I defined it 10, so it will go till 10, and as soon as it goes to, it will go till 9, and as soon as it goes till 10, this loop will break out of it, right? And now you can just, let's say, print it and see what the result is. So let's say the terms, it says enter the term, let's say I write 5, right? So it gave me the Fibonacci sequence till 5 terms, that is 0, 1, 1, 2, and 3. So these are the 5 basic terms that it gave me. So what happens is, let's say we run it for an error condition as well here. So let's say it says enter the term, and I write it as 0. So it says error, because to start the Fibonacci sequence, you have to have two digits here. Let's say I run it again, and this time I give the term as 1. So it says Fibonacci sequence is 0. Because for 1, it will always give me the value of x, and the value of x is 0. That's why it gave me the result as 0. Is this clear with everyone?
Yes, sir.
we can like repeat it for, let's say we want it for 10 terms, you can just print it and it will give you the answer for 10 terms, like first 10 terms of Fibonacci number 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21, and 34. Okay. So the basic logic behind your Fibonacci sequence is these three things here. That is what the main logic behind your Fibonacci number is, that whatever your next number will be, that will be updated value of the previous number, and your previous number will now shift to one more, like the next number, and the next number will be now become your product, that is whatever value that you got, and it will keep on iterating itself, right? So this was a very basic explanation of how you can run your Fibonacci sequence. Now we will be looking at one very basic example, application example of Python, and we all use it like in our day-to-day life, that is a calculator. Okay, so we'll see how we can build a calculator. Now here we will be building a very simple calculator that will only consist of four functions, like four basic arithmetic functions, that is addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. Now it's up to user. You can include as much arithmetic operations you want in that particular calculator, but just for an example, we will be using a calculator consisting of only four basic arithmetic operations, and we will be using the functions that we studied in our previous lecture. We will be using the functions, we will be giving it a particular parameter, and we will also be returning a value from those functions, right? So let's say I start off with saying that building a calculator, I'll just comment it up. Now I'll start, let's say now I want my four basic arithmetic operations to be inside a calculator. So what I can do is to create my calculator. Now my basic understanding is, let's say someone gives you a question saying, okay, build a calculator that has basic four arithmetic operations. So to the very easy way is that inside a calculator, now when we were doing the arithmetic questions, what we were doing is either we were initializing the variables or we were asking the user for an input, okay? But what happens in calculator is, when you open a calculator and you get that keypad to enter the values or add and subtract whatever number you want, calculator already has a predefined general formula of, let's say, addition or let's say subtraction. That is, if user gives me these two values and if user presses plus sign, I have to add these two numbers. So for that, the calculator already has a stored function for add. And that is a very easy way to do this, because instead of describing everything one line by line, this is the best way to optimize your calculator. That is, you create four basic functions that will store the general arithmetic operations, and then you will just call these functions and you will just give the input to the calculator, and then it will the value will be taken by the user, and also what exact arithmetic operation user wants to do, that will also be defined by the user. So in Python, we will take these two values and it will say, okay, these two are the numbers which are defined by the user, and user wants me to add these two numbers. So whatever function add is, Python will call that add function, input these two values in the function and give you the return value, that is the output, that is addition of those two numbers. Okay. So basic logic is clear with everyone, how we are going to build this?
Yes, sir.
Or should I explain it again?
Sir, can you explain it again?
Okay, sure. So what is happening is, now we are going to...